Bare feet and aircraft. Away from the rivers, these are principal means of transport in New Guinea, the great island we're visiting to join a geological expedition. Below the clouds live tribes who see aeroplanes passing daily, but who rarely see a white man face to face, except near the coast. There are a few roads in this mountainous territory, where only rivers penetrate towards the central highlands. On the lower reaches, tree-trunk canoes are paddled through slow currents, or speeded by outboard motor. There's very little freeboard. The big downriver cargoes come towards the coast by log raft, the timber being sold to a sawmiller at journey's end. One coastal village is about to launch a newly built canoe, following the traditions of an age-old ceremony. Imported enamel purchased at the trade store replaces the mellow ochre pigments of earlier days. Days when all clothing was of leaves and rustling grasses. Our own boating preparations are well underway. We're getting accustomed to the heat and have had immunizing shots against half a dozen tropical diseases. In order to travel further up the wild New Guinea headwaters than anyone has been before, we have brought Hamilton jet boats. Though built as light pleasure craft, they can face very tough conditions. Motors, jets and impellers have been checked, and we have welded up some new accessories, canopies to ward off tropical sun. Soon the New Zealanders have the boats ready, and the Australian geologists, under leader Duncan Dow, arrive to join them. Already bulk stores have gone ahead by coaster to Angoram on the Sepik River. Only last-minute supplies remain to be loaded now. First prospect is a coastal voyage, 150 miles to the Sepik mouth. At 30 miles an hour, that'll take 5 hours. Plenty of time to be filled in on the finer aims of the expedition.
It's always difficult to separate the purely academic interest from the practical ones in geology, just as in any other science. Most immediate practical objective, I think, in this exercise would be to find out if in this area we have, which is quite unknown geologically, we have rocks that are of the type that are likely to produce mineral deposits.
The briefing is from Dr. Fisher, Chief Geologist of the Australian Bureau of Mineral Resources.
The Sepik itself, which is the area we're in now, has been penetrated rather more than lots of the other inland parts of New Guinea because of the ready access through the big waterways. As the territory develops, no doubt there will be a need for all sorts of construction materials, road building materials, and so it's quite important, even in the early stages of development, to have a basic knowledge of the geology. The villages along the Sepik have given away their tambourines and are mostly accepted one of the mission religions. Well, these people, as everybody knows, are just about a generation out of the Stone Age.
From our supply base at Angoram, the boats head further up the Sepik to begin exploring its tributaries. Evolved in the shallow mountain torrents of New Zealand, the Hamilton boats are undaunted by snags and shallows. We soon find ourselves entering real jet boat country. speed through log-infested shallows, places where canoes or propeller craft would have to stop time and again and be hauled by hand. A country as New Guinea, first contact with strangers can be a little alarming, on one side or the other. In all accessible places throughout this Australian-administered territory, patrol posts include hospitals and sometimes schools. Though English is compulsory in the schools, it makes slow headway against the exasperating pidgin language. As this post has no trading store, there's little local use for money. Perhaps the savings bank receives the money we pay each day to enterprising small boys who bring us fruit and vegetables from the family gardens. They record songs for us too. Though the children sing mostly in English, the parents keep to traditional numbers with kundu accompaniment. Most of the singing, and women most of the work, from basket making to gardening. If the men find our cargoes awkward, it's only until they get used to them. Metal trail boxes, standard equipment in New Guinea fieldwork, are designed to be carried on a pole between two men. On a scientific expedition, such as this in very rough country, the awkward metal boxes go no further than base camp. The carriers who bring supplies are given the much more comfortable shoulder packs designed for tramping and mountaineering. One land party has gone out. Now another sets off by river. At base village, the life goes on. Not long ago, the mambu flute was a sacred object, not permitted to be seen or heard by women, children, or strangers. This sortie, we're going to examine the rocks near a remote mission station. To begin with, the Tagari Barrett presents no problems. Running through undeveloped tropical swampland, it has an abundance of bird life. Problem of islands of floating weed, but this is the first time we've run into it. At snail's pace, a floating island dislodged by the boat creeps downstream and reopens the channel. There is still no sign of open water, but it can't be far off. Luckily, we meet a local navigator who gives us our bearings. Floating islands of weed hamper navigation in much of the lower Sepik swamp country. But we're soon free of this lot and continuing our way to the huge Shambri Lake. The Kanganaman House Tambaran, or Men's Meeting House. The men sit within this club, attended by their dogs. Women, children and mosquitoes, we are told, are all strictly prohibited. Those powerful symbols of the old days, the garamuts, or slip drums, have lain silent beneath the building ever since the coming of the mission. The craftsmanship which made them now goes only into the building of canoes. Decorative as this is a rare thing today. Most have been dismantled and their carvings carried off to the museums of the world's capitals. The new meeting houses are unadorned and even children may enter. Seeker after the old ways is Scotsman Tom Sliman, a professional collector of artifacts. He tells us how the ancestral treasures of New Guinea have been sold off in the past.
I have got some few good pieces out, but I think it is it's just not around now. The genuine stuff is not around. The two gems that were here, and one is still here at the moment, Mr. Schuster, curator of the Basel Museum. And Mr. Haviland took 97 tons of carvings out about, I think, 4 years ago. And of course, Australia got very, very alarmed because of the stuff that's going. I believe they're sending a double canoe up very soon with a few authentic pieces out of the museum. And they're going on a tour around the sea peak to show these natives how their fathers used to, and grandfathers used to carve. I know one collector in Sydney who has a collection valued about £200,000. That is old stuff. He started collecting 35 years ago, so he was right in when the good stuff was around.
A man is lucky nowadays to acquire pieces that genuinely represent the district they come from, since easier travel has led to styles becoming mixed, as well as to a rarity of carvings such as this one, which are entirely free of European or Indonesian influence. Ibom Village has one native product that is rare in New Guinea, that is pottery. Dr. Fisher takes a break from geologizing to examine a handsome pottery fire basket. Small boys with endless curiosity about that great outside world beyond the floating islands are eager to see what the strange visitors will get up to next. Boulders at the village boundary have to be sampled, and their nature, they turned out to be granite, entered on the geological map. In the field, a hand lens is a simple aid to mineral identification, but only an expert can get much information from what he sees. The expedition has now pushed far enough from the main Sepik River to be in need of an advanced camp on one of the tributaries, the Ewart. Our cheerful helpers from the lower country are skilled at the work and clear the ground in no time. A clear side stream of the Ewart, called the Mut, provides boat anchorage and bathing pool when it's been slightly deepened. Some of these expert axemen have never seen a saw before, but are willing to give it a try. I'm sure it's very good, but I think I'll stick to the axe. Soon our New Guinea boat hotel on the banks of the Mut is complete. We have every comfort, even a refrigerator and a shower, for the camp is 100 miles, even from Angoram, and we'll live here almost a month. Since it comes down from the hills, the Mut is pleasantly cool. With camp construction work finished, everyone makes themselves fit for inspection. Overhead, saw the flying foxes, the black boccus. These giant bats, relics of the age of reptiles, are hunted for the pot. His curiosity makes easy game of the shoulder-high maruk, or cassowary, despite the fact that he can run as fast as a horse. The courier pigeon may not be hunted by Europeans. On the rare occasions when we have time for it, the fishing's excellent, with 80 pounders not uncommon. With the camp ready, Dr. Fisher arrives to inspect the work of the new area. From here, the jet boats are to push further up the Yurt into unmapped territory, guided by air photographs taken in the previous season.
Alright, behind him, water, you go on top. Alright, then we got garden along mountain.
Amungo?
Long, happy go, I wish. You savvy this for the first?
Yeah,
I'm going to say. AVME or AVME on top more, yeah?
AVME on top. One blouse.
Alright, behind him, water, you go on top through. Now, then we got garden on top through. Pulling in.
The rock has been confined to minor outcrops in the swamps. But now, around every bend of the Yurt, there's something to excite the geologists. Every change in the rock formation of the valley is sampled and recorded. It'll be a long time before there's needed road metal up here, or before any minerals found could be exploited. But the basic mapping must be done while means of access is available. Thanks to the jet boats, we can take the geologists further than even the patrols of the administration have penetrated. But so far up this river, we see no sign of human inhabitants. A big rapid ahead makes it prudent to put life jackets on again. It's also prudent to select a route from the bank before the boat with lightened load battles its way towards the next geological site. Miles further on, we're halted again. This time, a side stream is poured in huge boulders. Checking the outline map, the geologists call for a major effort to get through. If we bring up all hands and can find local tribal help, perhaps we can lift the boats above this raging cataract. After weeks of rough work in the wild, shallowing rivers, our jet boats must come ashore for attention. There's even rougher work to be expected as we go farther into the interior. Amos, our new Guinea mechanic, removes the intake screen. By now he knows all about Hamilton jet units. Fiberglass patches lie ready for healing bumps and bruises on the hulls. Working fiberglass is not so easy in tropical temperatures. Resins behave unpredictably, often setting before they can be applied to the work. Boats are ready. From Advanced Base up the Ewart, a tributary of the Sepik River, Australian geologists and the local carriers set out for a major push into unknown territory, driven by the New Zealand jet boat crews. In a few hours, we're at the limit of our previous exploration, for the unboatable cataract lies ahead. Above in the mountains live people whose gardens we've seen on air photographs. If we can make contact, perhaps they'll help us haul the boats past the obstruction. After a long, hot climb of 3,000 feet, we crest a ridge to see the river far below. Somewhere above, though, people have been watching us, and scouts from the village decide to make contact. The eventual meeting is a great experience on both sides. Gifts of salt and other goods proclaim that we come in peace. A fact the villagers signal to their fellow tribesmen across the valley.
Fajr.
There are some 700 languages in New Guinea, and this is one only the Wapi understand. But somehow we manage to convey our willingness to pay for the help that we seek, and they agree to come with us down the mountain. One piece of white man's equipment finds a willing carrier. These hill people are mostly healthy. Such complaints as they have, as man's conjunctivitis for example, are rapidly cured by our antibiotic medicines. Massive boulders carried down from the mountains by floods in this side stream have dammed the valley, making a cataract which has halted our boating progress in the Ewart. But near the water's edge there's plenty of forest timber with which we can devise a portage of some sort. Carriers, normally uneasy with people of the bush, rise to the occasion and delight in carrying the tribe's piccaninnies across a bridge hastily engineered over the stream. Except for hunting forays, it's not often that people of the hill villages make long excursions away from their homes and gardens. Having expected only a few warriors to come down, we're delighted that the affair has turned into a village picnic. At the foot of the cataract, a boat landing is prepared by our own carriers. They're pretty doubtful of getting much help from the incomprehensible mountain men, the real bushies who are swarming around. Long kunda vines grow to some hundreds of feet in length. When split, they make excellent ropes. In this land without nails, this is the only means by which our railway can be lashed together. Work goes on for 2 days, and then we have a passage across the boulders nearly 300 feet long. Subject to testing, it should easily carry the boat, a load of more than half a ton.
Hey!
jetboat expeditions, we've never needed a portage. The vertical fall in this cataract is some 30 feet. No more than in many of Colorado's Grand Canyon rapids, up which we jetboated successfully in 1960. But here the confined water of this much smaller river gives no room to maneuver amongst the boulders. Stone Age men, using their strong, rough bushcraft, have built a railway. The cataract has been successfully bypassed. Now all this is quite new country. A fine pandanus palm sends its aerial roots down to meet the ground. No geologist has been here before. In fact, no white man at all. The hills, which look like cattle country, are clothed in tall kunai grass of little value for grazing. More rapids add to the fun of driving up the ever-steepening river towards the great heights of the Central Mountains. The railway has given us access to 40 miles more river before broken water in a gorge halts the boating. Dr. Fisher, chief geologist of the Bureau of Mineral Resources, explains the importance of the work.
As you know, this recently been discovered a very large copper gold deposit on Bougainville Island, and there is a fairly strong revival of interest in mineral exploration in the territory. There are several mining companies who are doing active exploration work or looking the situation over, and this Sepik area is one that's always attracted some attention, largely because it's almost completely unknown. But we do know that the rocks throughout this area are of the type that do contain mineral deposits. There are numerous intrusive bodies, and there are old schists and slates, and it has been very poorly prospected in the past and prospected only for gold. So we aim to map the whole of this mountain area right west to the Indonesian border.
Day, and with a large slice of virgin country in the bag, we head downriver towards the railway. Perhaps while the Billy Tea is brewing, there's time to pan the river silt for gold. There have already been gold rushes in New Guinea, and we remember that it was early gold mining that first primed the economies of both Australia and New Zealand. In many places we found colour, traces not only of gold, but of silver and platinum. But enough of that, the billy's boiled. We'll have tea before returning to the railway and the WAP. Our carriers are sure the hunting must be better on the other bank. The Wapi, meanwhile, have been waiting to take us back down the railway.
Arrivederci. That was a good kid.
The river's dropped in the last few days, and the boulders in the stream are much more clearly visible. The last of the Cross River hunting party returns empty-handed. But come to think of it, empty-handed's the only way he could come across that current. Last sick calls are attended to as the boats prepare for departure. The Wapi, at our suggestion, wrapped their strong-smelling tobacco in paper wrappings from films. Usually they have to be satisfied with dried leaves. They smoke heavily at all ages, but there's no sign of fermented drink, in spite of a plentiful supply of fruit with which to make it. Back to base camp in the Mut, but some of us stay to return with the Wapi tribesmen through their land to survey the geology to the distant highlands. They're happy, self-confident people, and though continually at war with traditional enemies across the valley, are not the least nervous down here by the river, presuming no doubt that our presence gives them safety. Ahead once more is the 3,000 foot climb to the village. It is only in administered areas that people dare live in accessible places. This time, some of the Wapi are wearing the bright red lap-lap we have given them for their willing help down at the railway. We enter the village in proper ceremonial order, women last. One of our gift axes goes to work to cut tent poles. As our hosts learn the art of tent pitching, we can watch their sureness of movement and admire the purity of their dress, all made from forest materials. Both scene and climate are wonderfully different from that in the coastal villages.
You're going to go there.
Cooking up here is done with hot stones in buried earth ovens. This, in local idiom, is a moo-moo feast. Pit-pit, cow-cow, and taro are cooked between layers of banana leaves. As in much of the tropics, old people are scarcely seen. Not many smoke their pipes into a comfortable middle age. As we prepare to leave, vegetables are offered for sale. Salt, the most acceptable form of payment, is carefully wrapped away in banana leaves. As before, there are no maps to guide our next moves, only air photographs. The country is steep, ridges separated by deep valleys. A mile or so in the photograph may take many miles on the ground. A packet of dried silk from the creek gives a sort of instant geology of the country upstream. All through these hills, the villages are built up on the ridges for comparative safety. The fences are to keep the village pigs from straying.
It's difficult to see any highly cultural future for the peoples of the inaccessible highland villages in other countries. Peoples in such situations as this have remained fairly primitive because they just lack the means of contact and transport, and the nature of this country is such that transportation is always going to be a major problem.
Our fifth day in the hills, filling blanks on the geological map, has taken us away from the land of the Wapi. Carriers have been exchanged at each village en route. Soon we will return to civilization at the edge of the eastern highlands. Faithful bushies, carriers from the last village, are paid the wages they prefer, coarse twist tobacco, and a newspaper in which to roll it. In an hour's flight, the two-engine Piaggio covers the area of our 5 days' journey on foot. We're back over the cataract, with the Stone Age Railway just below the river junction. Following down the Ewart, we come to the clear Mut side stream with base camp still occupied. Downstream again, we're over the vast swamps of the Middle Sepik. Site of great rice fields of the future, or maybe oil fields, no one knows yet. And Angoram once more, from a different angle. Will this be the site of a city? The makings of the future in the vast mountainous island lie hidden in the ground. If great mineral wealth is proved, the means of transport will be found, and agriculture developed to feed a rising population. Leaving, we recall the great days with our Australian friends, sporting runs up the wild rivers and down them again. We remember our vigorous Stone Age helpers, the Wapi, and the hospitality of their pleasant mountain villages. As New Guinea changes, we hope that none of the good humour of these people will be lost. Like other developing countries, they will be involved in a gigantic economic and social leapfrog to bridge them with the present European day. The Goroka Show of 1966 seems to suggest that New Guinea is just entering the door of a century much earlier than ours. Join a geological expedition. Below the clouds live tribes who see aeroplanes passing daily, but who rarely see a white man face to face, except near the coast. There are few roads in this mountainous territory, where only rivers penetrate towards the central highlands. On the lower reaches, tree trunk canoes are paddled through slow currents, or speeded by outboard motor. There's very little freeboard. The big downriver cargoes come towards the coast by log raft, the timber being sold to a sawmiller at journey's end. One coastal village is about to launch a newly built canoe, following the traditions of an age-old ceremony. Imported enamel purchased at the trade store replaces the mellow ochre pigments of earlier days. Days when all clothing was of leaves and rustling grasses. Our own boating preparations are well underway. We're getting accustomed to the heat and have had immunizing shots against half a dozen tropical diseases. In order to travel further up the wild New Guinea headwaters than anyone has been before, we had brought Hamilton jet boats. Though built as light pleasure craft, they can face very tough conditions. Motors, jets and impellers have been checked, and we have welded up some new accessories, canopies to ward off tropical sun. Soon the New Zealanders have the boats ready, and the Australian geologists, under leader Duncan Dow, arrive to join them. Already bulk stores have gone ahead by coaster to Angoram on the Sepik River. Only last-minute supplies remain to be loaded now. The first prospect is a coastal voyage, 150 miles to the Sepik mouth. At 30 miles an hour, that'll take 5 hours. Plenty of time to be filled in on the finer aims of the expedition.
It's all everybody knows, just about a generation out of the Stone Age.
From our supply base at Angoram, the boats head further up the Sepik to begin exploring its tributaries. Evolved in the shallow mountain torrents of New Zealand, the Hamilton boats are undaunted by snags and shallows. We soon find ourselves entering real jet boat country. Log-infested shallows, places where canoes or propeller craft would have to stop time and again and be hauled by hand. Wild a country as New Guinea, first contact with strangers can be a little alarming. On one side or the other,
it's difficult to separate the purely academic interest from the practical ones in geology, just as in any other science. Most immediate practical objective, I think, in this exercise would be to find out if in this area we have, which is quite unknown geologically, we have rocks that are of the type that are likely to produce mineral deposits.
The briefing is from Dr. Fisher, Chief Geologist of the Australian Bureau of Mineral Resources.
The Sepik itself, which is the area we're in now, has been penetrated rather more than lots of the other inland parts of New Guinea because of the ready access through the big waterways. As the territory develops, no doubt there'll be a need for all sorts of construction materials, road building materials, and so it's quite important even in the early stages of development to have a basic knowledge of the geology. The villages along the Sepik have given away their tambourines and are mostly accepted one of the mission religions. Well, these people, as a